Okay, let's touch briefly into AI, just to give a glimpse of what will become another next podcast we could do. So let's imagine that we have progressed in this conversation from backbone for the force for good through all these different layers of the stack up to the idea of these collaborative repositories in GitHub, traditionally of computer code, but now we're talking also about using the same tools and technologies to bring forth knowledge. So you can imagine, just like there's all these repositories of computer code, we're moving towards a place where there will be all these unique, decentralized, yet coordinatable and mutually improvable repositories of knowledge. AI brings an amazing capability to the human species because it's able to look across those repositories of knowledge and make sense of them and bring forth good and useful things from them. And then we're also developing fractal AI capabilities, for instance, where we now have multiple levels of AI capabilities interfacing with the Lionsburg Wiki, for instance, that's able to have varying levels of creativity. So we can now query and say, okay, according to the Lionsburg Wiki, what are some likely patterns for human governance and economy and, you know, over the coming generation? And an AI can make sense of those millions of words of writing and bring back some useful sources and summaries. And we're moving towards back to this right decentralization and centralization issue. We're moving towards a era and a design where our current hypothesis through Lionsburg is we're very close to the ability to match up individual organizations with their own dynamic knowledge repositories, let's call them, with their own localized AIs that can both make sense of their own private repositories without peeking over the walls at other repositories that people might want to keep private, while at the same time being able to, you know, contextualize that with what's happening really across the world and make sense of that all. So I guess I just open it up for, you know, that's kind of the leading layer of the tech stacks we're building. And, you know, feel free to comment on that as much as you would like that here today, and then leave off wherever you'd like. And we can pick up with a deeper discussion on AIs and its opportunities and threats.
I think that's a great overview. That was a great overview, Jordan. I think you did something interesting there. You said make sense of, it's something that we've never had before. We've got the ability to have something that understands language, look over a corpus of a million words, and pick out in context of a question where I've expressed something in human language or you've expressed something in human language, maybe even a different language than English, right? Over a corpus of a language that I don't know or something like that. The AI tools are able to discern and perceive what those corpuses are made of, and it can look for hotspots that make sense, right? I have to say she's a linguist. Emily Bender said something really interesting recently. She said the outputs of these large language models they're not made sense. They don't make sense. It's humans that make sense of it. So what the tool can do is find the things that seem relevant. I struggle with this too. A lot of times it's hard not to say, or maybe a better way to say that, we don't have language yet. We don't have language for what's happening when an AI is thinking or deciding or seeing or understanding or making sense. We just don't have the word for it. So we end up using a human word. You know, it understands the language is something that I say all the time. I'm reminded by some of my friends, hey Pete, it's actually not really understanding. It's just doing kind of a statistical relevance thing that the only language we have for it is understand or make sense. So the thing to remember is that they're not yet smart in the way humans are. On the flip side, they are capable of automated, I'm going to use this word understanding because I don't have a better one, understanding of large swaths of language, right? Millions of words at a time are like child's play to it. It's like, yeah, of course I can kind of grasp all of that and I can tell you what the interesting bits and bobs are of it, you know? So it's a super wonderful time to be around. And another kind of language expert who's been studying systems, Ethan Mollick, just today he wrote a summary of where we are, he says, a year later, since ChatGPT came out. It seems like ancient history now when ChatGPT came out, but it's literally only been a year. It's easy at this point to remember a few years before ChatGPT, when AI was developing and started to come together, but hadn't reached the conversational nature that turned everybody on to large language models. Only a couple of years ago, I remember you and me and our friends wondering how we would make sense of a large corpus, how we would get six large corpuses together and figure out what were the commonalities, what was the common wisdom among them, what was the differences between them, or a transcript, right? 100 hours of transcripts. It was wonderful that we had speech recognition and speech recognition that could turn 100 hours of people talking into text. But then it became an indigestible chunk of text. Yeah. It was like something that we could say, in the future, there'll be a system that can help us make sense of all this. And now they're here. It's an amazing and wonderful time. So it's super, really, super, super cool.